This week's episode of the Disney Nerds Podcast is brought to you by Kingdom Strollers. Kingdom Strollers rents premium strollers in the Orlando area. Whether it be a single, double, or special needs, they can help you out. Kingdom Strollers is also Disney approved, which means they can deliver directly to your hotel and pick it up when you're done. The next time you're headed to the Orlando area, don't pay extra to fly with your stroller. Save that room in your trunk for those extra pair of tennis shoes you'll know you'll need. Contact our friends over at Kingdom Strollers at www.kingdomstrollers.com.
Welcome to the splendor, the spectacle, the sparkling sensation, where the romance, the comedy, and the thrill of Disney fantasies come to electric life.
And as our friend Jiminy said, welcome to the Disney Nerds Podcast. A place each week where like-minded people get together to discuss all things Disney. We'll help you get your Disney fix on. Here we go.
A Magic Kingdom proudly presents, in a million points of musical light, the magical worlds of Disney.
Hello and welcome to show number 298 of the Disney Nerds Podcast. Hey guys, how's it going? And welcome back to the show. This is Ed, and on this week's show, it's going to be all about Food and Wine 2019. Before we get started, let's introduce who we have with us tonight. Hey Jimmy, how's it going?
I am fantastic.
Oh, good to hear. Are you drying out down there in New Orleans?
Yes, we're doing well. Actually, I got to get my lawn cut yesterday for the first time in probably about 3 weeks.
Nice. Must have been a jungle.
It was pretty bad. The backyard was pretty bad. My front yard doesn't get too terrible, but the backyard was pretty rough.
Well, that's good. Well, I'm glad it was like underwhelming compared to the predictions they had out for it.
Yeah, it just was an excuse to hang out and barbecue and drink beer.
Isn't everything?
Yeah, like I needed any other excuses to do those things.
Yeah, well, very cool. Well, good. Okay, guys, just want to talk about real quick the blog. We've got a lot of different things going on over there. There's some great stories about the dates and times for the Halloween party, which I think you're already going, aren't you?
I am. I'll be there on Labor Day, September 2nd. Me and Kim will be there. Actually, I was thinking about what we may be able to do as far as costumes. I was thinking about that today.
No, very cool. So it's the Mickey's Not So Scary Halloween Party.
I read it, and there's some stuff changing. There's quite a few things changing this year. And they had some things that changed last year that are staying the same this year, but then they're also changing some other stuff. So it's definitely changing rapidly. I definitely recommend going check the article out if you haven't read it.
Okay, definitely. Worth the while. We also had an article about there. It looks like we have an opening date for the gondolas.
That's cool.
Yep.
It'll definitely be open after my September trip, which is Labor Day week, but before we head down for the Disney Nerds Podcast meetups in November. So me and you may be experiencing that one together. Maybe we'll have to go and do that together.
Oh, no doubt. Hopefully they get all the bugs out of the system by the time we get down there and everything's running smooth.
Yeah, I shared with you guys the other day about some pictures I saw on Facebook that they were practicing the fire rescue from the water.
Oh, right. Yep, I saw that, which you knew they'd have to eventually.
I don't want to be involved in it, though. I don't want to be the one they get to practice on early. But I would, so when we're there in November, you know, maybe me and you and Kim can go take a ride over and or leave Epcot and, I don't know, hop on one of them.
Oh, no doubt. We're going to have to do that just to check it out. I mean, we'll make an excuse to go somewhere. Another great article on the blog is a great way to keep cool at Disney World. We also have another one from Disneyland. Kind of coincide. You can kind of trade tips from either article. I thought it was pretty cool. So definitely check out the Disney Nerds Podcast blog.
I have not been to Disneyland, but it's my understanding it's much easier to keep cool there than Walt Disney World.
Yes and no. they have a lot of ride lines outside. And that was always the downside. Some of them are covered, some of them weren't. So it did get kind of warm, but Disneyland itself is just in such an area. It's never really getting that hot like it is every day down in Florida.
Sure.
So that's what kind of saves it a little bit.
You use, when you're in down in Walt Disney World, do you use the cool towels?
We try to, but not religiously. I think it's kind of too cumbersome at points because it's hard to keep it on and stuff like that unless you're holding it and playing around with it a lot. The last time we went down there, we found this really cool one with Velcro that kind of worked a little bit better. Just wet the neckerchief or the bandana and then use that to cool it down.
We had bought one and brought it with us, and then we had the kids with us, so then we ended up buying one of the ones from Disney, and I think they work pretty well. I agree that, you know, they're kind of tough to hang on to and a little bit cumbersome. Like, what do you do with them? But nice to keep. Like, Kim would just keep them in a Ziploc bag in her backpack,
mm-hmm.
or my backpack, and then just when you're walking a decent distance to be able to pull it out and just kind of rub your head and neck.
Now there is an issue with that, is that you have a little short shelf life as far as putting it in the baggie. If it continues to go in there and it's warm, it does start to kind of get stinky. You got to keep really washing it and rinsing it and stuff.
It's a very good point. And the best thing I could recommend for that also to keep cool is when you're walking by one of those places that have the tubs of soft drinks.
Oh, don't.
A handle ice.
Okay. Let's keep going. I was afraid you were going to say something. Go ahead.
What were you afraid I was going to say?
You had to dip it in there and wring it out.
No. Grab a handful. I just grabbed a couple cubes of ice off the top of it,
mm-hmm.
and then wrapped the cubes of ice in the cool towel.
Oh, yeah, that's great. Pouring ice water on it's awesome, too. Then just wring it out, and it's got that actual like coolness to begin with. But the whole technology of it totally works. I mean, I get it, and it does work. You wring it out, you kind of do that little flick, and then you put it on, and it definitely does cool you down.
Now you made me think about that. I'm sure lots of people shove those things in those damn drink bins.
Oh, that's horrible. I hope not. I hope not. The things that you purposely ignore when you go away on vacation with thousands of other people. Okay, well, that's a show for another day. And for the germaphobes on our podcast, we're going to stay away from that for tonight. What we are going to talk about, though, is food and wine, which is just around the corner.
I like food and wine.
It works out, and I like how you can use the word wine, but it covers anything you can drink.
Pretty much does. It's not just wine. I mean, most of the global marketplaces,
right? That's the name for it. The kiosks of food.
The kiosks, but the technical word that Disney uses is global marketplaces. So most of those places will have a wine, but they also have a beer, and some of them will also have a cocktail.
Right, and we're going to go through menus in a couple minutes, and we're not going to really spend a lot of time on the beverages, but there are definitely some that do stand out enough to mention, so we will talk about that a little bit.
Especially the ones that pair well with something on the menu, like something that you go, you know what, that probably would be really good with that food item.
And I haven't really been steered too far or too wrong too many times with that whole thing. Every once in a while, though, it's a definite miss, but you try it.
I would be remiss if I didn't mention that the Disney Nerds Podcast annual meetups are November 8th and 9th, and the one on November 8th is our half sample-thon. This is the sixth year we've done the meetups, believe it or not.
That's great. That's awesome.
So on November 8th at 5 o'clock, I think it is, you can go to the Disney Nerds Podcast Facebook page and go to the event section, but we'll be meeting in Canada and working our way over to the American Adventure. Stopping by all the booths along the way. And I'm sure we'll be doing a preview of that eventually.
Oh, I'm sure we will. And we're actually trying to get ourselves another event for that day, too, to be a little earlier on Friday afternoon before the sample-thon that, you know, later in the afternoon happens.
Yep.
Okay, so let's get on to the food. Now, before we go into the menus and the different types of global marketplaces we have this year, there are the different parts of the food and wine experience that we've taken advantage of kind of on and off over the past couple years, and we just want to touch base on them. We're not going to go too much in detail at this point. We will definitely down the road once we start doing some of these events, and you'll hear us all kind of giving our reviews and talking about them and such. The party for the senses which is pretty cool. Now, that's one of those ticketed events that I think is pretty much a nighttime event. I've never been, but the what they offer is pretty incredible.
I've never been to that one. So it's a completely special ticketed event, and it's basically a party. So it looks cool.
Right. So if you're into that, now the specialty dining and pairings, that's a really nice event where it's a little bit more formal than we'll mention some of the tastings down there also. And these things are all scheduleable right now. If you go to food and beverage or you go to food restaurants and things like that at Epcot, you can go out there and start scheduling your things now. Another big thing they have with the food and wine is always the Eat to the Beat concert series. And I'm pretty sure we have a post out there already on our blog with all the different bands that are going to be there this year.
There were a lot of them announced. There is a post out there, and a lot of them were announced. Not 100% of them, though. For our meetup, it'll be the Hooters.
Again.
Again.
Second year in a row. That's awesome. And we're all going to make sure we know more than the one song this year, too, so we can sing along.
I'm going to start listening. I'm a Hooters super fan before the event.
But we all knew that one song. Everybody was great with that one.
Yep.
And, of course, the Eat to the Beat dining packages, which I haven't taken advantage of, and I couldn't tell you how many years, just because the Eat to the Beat concert is so loud, you really can hear it everywhere. You don't really need a good seat for it, but those packages are definitely available.
We always end up on my planter.
Right, right.
Typically for those, because you can hear it, everything fine from right there. You don't have to crowd in there, and you're close to food and drinks and stuff like that. So,
and if you come out to meet up with us for that half sample-thon, we end up over by the American Experience, kind of just hanging out on those planters over there, which are perfect seats, benches, and we basically are there to check out the band. We're making our way around World Showcase to get ourselves some seats for the Hooters this year, which is going to be. And it's a fun place because you know what? You're hanging out there, and people are kind of going around to the kiosks in that walking range and hooking up with drinks and food, and it's a great place to relax. I don't think it's ever been crowded in the last 5 years we've done it. It's been a very, very relaxed atmosphere.
Another thing to check out, and I don't remember exactly what the schedule is, but the Eat to the Beat concert has always been the same. I think it's 5:45, 6:30, and 8 o'clock were the times. And now they've changed it. So if you go to the DisneyNerdsPodcast.com and go to the blogs and find that one, on the weekends, during the week it's the same, but on the weekends they've changed the times a little bit to where that last show, I think, is at a little bit later. I think it's at like 9 instead of 8 or something like that. But go check it out at the DisneyNerdsPodcast.com. I like that because on the weekends during Food and Wine, they keep Epcot open till 10 instead of 9. So you don't have as much of a gap between that last concert and then Illuminations or Epcot Forever now.
Right. And they always kind of throw that at you last minute. And it used to be a surprise that Epcot was opening up till 10 because, to be honest with you, out of all the parks, Epcot is one of the most regular. Opens at 9, closes at 9. It's really pretty much right on that other than extra magic hours.
Yeah, it opens at 9. World Showcase opens at 11. And then the whole park closes at 9, typically, unless there's extra magic hours. You're right.
And that's almost religious. All the other parks, very, very, very...
Change all the time, yeah.
Anyway, so another thing that they offer for the food and wine events, and some of the things that we've participated in, are the food and beverage tastings. So now, basically what you do is you go to these 45-minute seminars where they talk about a specific liquor, vodka, brandy, wine... And to be honest with you, the entire schedule for this year is basically all wine, and we are not wine drinkers.
If during the time we're there, it's pretty much all wine. There are some liquors in there. I think Bullet Bourbon will be there, and it just depends. Each, you know, they send their representative, and we've done this a couple times. If you're going to be there, though, and there's a brand you like or a type of liquor that you like, it's definitely worth it because it's only like $15 a person.
Right. It is pretty cheap for what you get.
Yeah, you get and it's entertaining. I mean, it's just the entertainment is probably worth the $15, but then you also get a couple drinks out of it. So
right. You're going to at least get 3 drinks. I think that was at least what we got each year, and we might have gotten a 4th one year. And it's really cool in that they show you how to make it. They'll come around with the drinks. They pass them out. Everybody gets to taste it, and then you keep on rotating through. So a pretty fun thing. Now, what they're going to offer this year that's new is, and there's a great article about it Sam did like last week, is they're going to have this Monday Night Football tailgate tasting. I guess what's going to happen is the Monday Night Football crew is going to host it for you, and it happens on Sundays. So every Sunday during Food and Wine, they're going to have this event. It's only about 45 minutes, so not sure exactly what they do. The pictures I saw online looks like it's going to happen in the Food and Wine Center, you know, down in the old Pavilion, Life Pavilion. But I'm not sure.
Yeah,
I'm not sure where it's going to be now, or if that's where it's going to be for real or not.
I think it's going to be, you know, for the Arts Festival, they moved it to the old Odyssey. I don't think that's big enough, though, to house the Food and Wine.
But think about the last couple of years of Food and Wine in the Wonders of Life Pavilion. It's been whittling down. They haven't had as many, like, exhibits.
Yeah, but just the seating for the seminars takes up so much space. I mean, the Odyssey's small.
Yeah, good point. You got that right. Yes, because they had like four stage areas inside there, along with the restaurant, and then all the different like vendors.
Yeah,
is what it was. So yeah, you get a good point there. Maybe they'll even break it up.
Maybe they'll do it in separate two different locations. When me and you were having the conversation about this tailgate tasting,
right? Because we were debating it, because we'll be down there for the Sunday before our meetup. We'll both be down, and we're debating if we're going to do this or not. Go ahead.
Kept throwing me off because you're like, well, this game is this time on Sunday. I'm like, but it's a Monday night football thing. What are we talking about?
I know, right? That does kind of throw it off. Well, it's the host. They're working Monday night. They have something to do.
I get it. I didn't understand that they were there. I thought that was just a themed around Monday night football since it's ESPN. And I'm like, well, why isn't it on Sunday? I couldn't wrap my head around it, but I get it because it's the people from Monday Night Football that's going to kind of be hosting it. It's not on Monday night.
Right, and it makes sense it's only 45 minutes because they're going to be out of there like right after it, and they're going to wherever the game's going to be.
Yeah.
One other thing we're going to talk about before we get back onto the kiosks to the marketplaces is they have this candy sushi thing that they're going to be running over at the Land Pavilion, which totally reminds me back in the day. Remember they used to have that baking type of thing you can have with the kids over there in the Land.
I don't recall that.
Was it Nestle's or somebody? And you basically dressed up like a chef. They taught you how to bake something. It might have been cookies. I have to ask the kids. Excuse me. They haven't done that in a while. But it kind of totally reminds me of that, because you sat in those back tables back all the way in a corner, kind of next to where the line was for the Land. And you did this with the Disney cast members. It was fun. So they're offering that this year. It looks really cool.
I love stuff like that.
Sushi candy. Yeah,
that's cool that they're doing something like that kind of for kids, too, to get the kids involved in kind of the Food and Wine thing. Because I feel like mostly it's such an adult event. But that's cool that they do a little something like that for the kids.
Mm-hmm. I'm sure there's going to be more than that. We'll have to keep our eyes open. Okay, so now here's the big part. We're going to talk about the different things that are going to be offering us this year at the Food and Wine kiosks. Okay, so we're going to do it alphabetically this time around because it's a little easier. Now, Disney's website, if you want to go check out some of these things we're talking about, has it together already, which is really kind of cool. 9 times out of 10, or I should say how many years out of how many years in the past, we've had to go to other different websites that have been attending the different events they have before Food and Wine, and then they get the menus. This year, though, it seems like Disney's definitely got it together, which is pretty cool.
I'll give a little shout out since we used their stuff for like the past 5 years. But I think the past 5 years in a row, you know, we've always used Disney Food Blog, which does a great job for these type of events. So I'll give them a shout out.
Yep, definitely. Okay, so we're going to go one by one, and we're going to hit the name of it. Basically, the majority of the kiosks we're going to talk about this year have been there before. I think there's only maybe one or two new ones.
They've got it down to a science. I mean, the ones they have are, you know, the ones that don't work, they get rid of and they replace it and they find one that does work. And now they've got it pretty much where they're all just really good.
Right. And it's kind of cool seeing that most of the ones we're kind of familiar with, they've been there a bunch of years. They always have that one great, you're used to it type menu item, but they keep changing other things out, which I think is pretty cool because they're looking for that next good thing. Okay, so let's start with Active Eats, which is kind of an odd name because it doesn't really belong to a country, but it definitely gives you some great different alternatives and healthy alternatives. Although, saying that, we're starting out with the loaded mac and cheese, with nuskas, pepper bacon.
Nuskas.
Let's just say they're going to put some pepper bacon on that and make it taste that much better. Now, I think this is different for them is that they have salmon this year. I don't remember that being on the menu.
I don't think so.
A spice-crusted salmon with Uncle Ben's
quinoa.
Yeah, I know. I learned that word the other day. and crushed avocado. See, they just lost it for me. And then they have a really cool fruit nut energy type of dessert. As far as the beverages go, a couple beers, a couple wines. Nothing really sticks out there at all.
Now, this is going to be up by up behind, like, Club Cool, right?
And they have been moving a lot of them back to where that Butterfly Garden was for the flower show.
Yeah.
And that whole area right outside Club Cool. You're right. Yeah, more than likely it'll be up there. I totally agree with you there. And they've kind of manicured that area specifically for these festivals. Yeah, so why not? Okay, as we keep going down, we're going to stop at Africa. And this year they kind of got a little bit of a change up because they always have that Berber beef or something. I can't remember the exact name of it, but that
Berber beef with the pap.
Right. This year it's a Kenyan coffee barbecue beef tenderloin with sweet potato and corn mealy pap.
There's your pap.
And some kachumbari slaw, the coffee thing, that just has me so interested. I mean, are you going to taste coffee? Is it going to be part of it? I'm going to try that. That's actually on my list.
I guess it's got to be in the sauce.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, no doubt. It's kind of like the mole sauce, Mexican-wise, I'm sure. You know, they kind of use it as the extra ingredient. Spicy Kenyan vegan githeri with white beans is another offering. And they also have piri-piri skewered shrimp with citrus-scented couscous.
Oh, see, that sounds like that's right in my wheelhouse.
I was thinking the same exact thing. That sounds really, really good. So Africa, definitely on my list this year. As far as their offerings... Okay, here's one that stands out. They have a Groot Constantia Pinotage. I'm a horrible wine person. But it has the name Groot in it. How do you pass that up?
I would say Pinotage.
Oh, it's like a Pinot.
I would say that just because it starts with Pinot.
Yep, I agree.
I am Groot.
I am Groot. That's a cool wine name. Okay, so now I'm pretty sure the next country we're hitting is a new one. It's the Alps,
which interesting
to me is pretty cool.
The delicious taste of the Swiss-inspired dishes.
Right. Now, the Alps, that's an odd one. You know how they have the Caribbean kiosk down the road, which covers a couple of different islands and areas? I would have thought the Alps would have covered maybe Italy, France, and Switzerland because they're all kind of like cornered up in that one area.
Well, you have the French Alps and then you have the Swiss Alps. Alpine mountains, but it's two different.
Oh, true. And that's what made me think of it because they just said the Alps. But either way, let's get back to the food.
French Alps.
Right. So anyway, warm, don't know what this is, rosselet Swiss cheese with baby potatoes, cornicones and baguette. So that sounds like something on bread. A venison stew with crushed potatoes. And a blueberry and almond frangipane tart with creme fraiche cream. Very cool. Nothing really stands out until I see some pictures maybe down the road and some samples where people have given me ideas.
Cornichons?
Yes.
They look like it's a cucumber.
Oh, okay. Well, there you go.
It's a pickled cucumber. So I just Googled it just because I had never heard of that before. I was actually thinking it was like pork skins.
Oh, okay.
Sure. But that's like chicharrones. It's different.
Gotcha. Now, as far as beverages go, again, your standard wines. However, somebody might like this. They have frozen rosé. So that sounds like a rosé slushy.
It's called frosé. Frozen rosé.
And again, you never know what's going to be the next big hit. Continuing on, we're at the Appleseed Orchard. So now, right away, just hearing that, I'm imagining not a lot of food, but a lot of drink, and we're correct. We have the cheese plate. And
charcuterie board?
Like, I'm sorry?
Charcuterie and cheese plate?
Yep, right, which I've seen, never had. And the other offering here, which I'm definitely going to have to try this one out, caramel apple popcorn. I like my flavors on my popcorn. As far as the beverages, they've got more than a dozen different flavors.
A lot of stuff.
And kind of just breezing through here, it's a lot of the ciders. So you've got cherry apple, you've got spiced apple, you've got green apple, you've got apple pie beer, you've got apple trap Belgian style. You've got Kurt Russell's Goji Wines Pinot Noir. And just because the Kurt Russell's name, that stands out big time. They also have a mixed drink, an Apple Blossom Sky. Phantom Apple, Ginger Beer, Floodwall Apple Brandy, Burton's Maplewood Farm Applejack Brandy Barrel Aged Syrup, and Mini Marshalls.
God.
Wow.
They have a they're going to have a cider flight, so this will be up Lisa's alley for sure.
I'll be hitting this one, too, for the cider. I'm a big fan of that. And there's some great flavors going on in here, so, yeah, fun.
Off topic, but just the last trip to Disney, I was at the Abracadabar,
mm-hmm.
and they have a dry cider on draft that is very good. I prefer dry cider.
I've never had one on draft, so I got to try that out. I can go either way on that. I think it just depends on the cider itself. I had some great ones up in Boston. Okay, moving on to Australia. A tried but true.
I feel like this is going to be a lot of meat.
Yeah, you think so? Grilled sweet and spicy bushberry shrimp with pineapple, pepper, onion, and snap peas. Now, that sounds different. They've always had shrimp, but that one does sound a little different. The roasted lamb chop, that is their tried but true steady thing there. With sweet potato puree, bushberry pea salad, and pistachio pomegranate gramolta. They're dressing it up a little different. And a deconstructed pavlova with pastry cream, citrus. You know, the desserts I'm going to have you guys take a look at. I'm sure it's probably really good. Just tough to say.
Yeah.
But sounds great. So, and the drinks, kind of the same type stuff. A couple beers, the Outback wine, Shiraz.
No Foster's?
No. How's that?
I thought Foster's was Australian for beer.
Cooper's Brewery Original Pale Ale is the top one on the list, so they might be the new guy. Okay, moving over to Belgium. Now, this one is another one that was always kind of a standard stop.
Yeah, I've always skipped it. I mean, it's always been pretty much waffles.
I was going to say, it's more the dessert stop than anything it is. Yeah. But they still have that beer-braised beef served with smoked Gouda mashed potatoes.
That actually sounds good.
It does. And the smoked Gouda mashed potatoes sound new, but I could be wrong. So definitely if I say something wrong, please don't hold it against me. I'm trying to think as far as what we were ordering, what we really liked. They have a beverage called Delirium Red Fruit Beer. Now, that's just a hell of a name, which I might have to try that one out.
I think we'll have to at least try that. That's what's so good about going with a few people is that, you know, you get stuff like that. Like, there's a beer flight there available. So you get the flight, and everybody kind of tastes them. And usually somebody, each person is going to really like one thing, you know?
Sure, and you get to go back and kind of just get that one beer and then dig it.
Yep.
Okay, moving on to Brazil. Wow, we're not getting through this too quickly. Here we go again with pronunciation. So I apologize big time. Moqueca, Brazilian seafood stew featuring scallops, shrimp, and whitefish with coconut lime sauce and steamed rice. That actually sounds really good too. I think we're going to say that a lot tonight.
This is my favorite right here. You're about to say my favorite.
Yep, and this is their standard, the crispy pork belly with black beans, tomato, and onions. Now, I got to tell you, 7 times out of 10, this is a great meal. Those 3 times out of 10, you got to be careful what kind of cut of pork belly you're getting because sometimes there's really not a lot of meat going on there.
Yep, I agree.
But for the most part, it is a pretty good one. And then the Brazilian cheese bread, which is pretty cool. Nothing really standing out to me as far as the beers go.
I will tell you this, and look, I'm not typically a dark beer drinker, mm-hmm. but the first one, the MIA Beer Company Barbosa Black Beer,
okay,
is really, really good. And it's got a Pirates of the Caribbean tie.
Okay, we'll throw a check on that one for the list. Okay, moving on. Now, the Brewers Collection, I'm having a hard time calling this a real place to kind of hit as far as a kiosk or such like that. And they've only got a couple beers there this year. Very, very German sounding. Although they got a pomegranate beer, so that's kind of an interesting twist.
Schaffenhofer is the same people that make the grapefruit beer right. in Canada, so that's just a different spin on probably the same thing.
Yep. Canada. Now, I could be wrong, but I thought Canada at least gave three offerings. They're down to just two. The Canadian cheddar cheese soup and the wild mushroom beef filet mignon.
I bet that's because the line is always so damn long there. I bet they figured, look, these are the two popular items. Let's just do these two and crank them out.
Oh, that's right. There's no dessert at all or anything like that. Right. Yeah, why not? And they do unload a lot of that stuff in there. And it's good. That's the only downside is it's very good. You just have to convince yourself that spending, was it $8 for the filet mignon or $7 was worth it?
The line. To me, it's the time in line. The line is always longer than booth.
Just depends when you hit it, but yeah.
It's one of the more popular dishes, and it's right in the front when you come in, so nobody's full yet. Everybody's walking in hungry.
Mm-hmm. Right. Well, you know, that's one to hang out till then. Okay, moving on to the Cheese Studio, hosted by Borson Cheese. I'm not a big cheese fan. It's not a good... To me, like, the heat doesn't really yell, you know, cheese. But braised beef stroganoff with tiny egg noodles, wild mushrooms, and Parmesan garlic and fine herbs cheese sounds really good, though.
Yep.
Black pepper souffle with fig marmalade and a maple bourbon cheesecake with maple bourbon cream. I'm sure we're going to be hearing a lot about that one as people start tasting these things. As far as the drinks go, blueberry wine. I mean, I feel like they kind of went back to the old MD 2020 days and they kind of picked up on the flavors and are starting to produce it. So it's like an actual wine that people want to drink now.
2020, you're showing your age.
Oh, geez. Yeah, well. But so blueberry, definitely something to try out. So fun stuff. Moving on to China.
I'm waiting for you to open this one up because one of my favorite things is there. And it's not there, I don't think.
Well, right away, I'm noticing that they're offering Wuzi spare ribs. Chicken dumplings and Chinese slaw is another one. Mala chicken and shrimp bao bun. That is totally different, and that's a hell of a mix-up. Chicken and shrimp on the bao bun. And then the black pepper shrimp with garlic noodles. They've had that while.
I'm so mad.
What was the one you wanted? What was it? It was the beef crispy on the bao bun, right?
Oh, the crispy duck on the bao bun.
Okay, all right. I knew it was on the bao bun. Now, the bao bun is that really great kind of consistency roll. It's almost like springy, spongy type of really goodness. And I get, you know, this isn't going to be bad. I guarantee it's still going to be good.
Oh, that's probably going to be delicious. The crispy duck was fantastic.
As far as drinks go, standard, wow, just bunches of mixed type of punches and bubble teas and things like that.
Most of that at the tea stand.
Normally,
yeah. I'm pretty sure a lot of that you can get already.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, here's another one, which, again, you think about it, considering we're in Florida during the summertime and into the fall, and it's a really hot place, we have the Chocolate Studio, which was a liquid nitro chocolate almond truffle with warm whisked caramel, so I guess it's hard as it goes into the thing. A dark chocolate raspberry tart with whipped cream.
With the first one we've kind of seen before, when Sam's been live and Sam's done videos from some of the dessert parties, that they take that stuff and put it in the liquid nitro and freeze it, mm-hmm. and then put sauce over it.
Well, they had something last year that was frozen. That was.
I think you're right. Yep.
It was on our way to Canada right before you got to the normal path, kind of like what we were saying before. They had all those different restaurants outside of Club Cool, and you follow that other pathway. Yeah. I can't remember what that was. We'll think of it. Actually, it was pretty good, if I remember right. Okay, well, so we're moving on, and we're moving over to another place called Coastal Eats. And this is kind of like Pacific Coastline Eats, where we have lump crab cake with Napa cabbage slaw and avocado lemon grass cream. I won't get that. Baked shrimp and scallop scampi dip with sourdough baguette, which sounds really awesome. And a Pacifico True Striped Bass Tostada with slaw and fire-roasted tomatillo sauce.
Tomatillo
sauce. I would be all for the second two totally.
This would be the last one, that tostada. I bet with that crispy on that crispy tostada. Oh, with the slaw and the sauce. That's the one in the picture. Oh my god.
Yeah, this will definitely be my seafood stop. Nothing really major drink wise.
No.
Nah. Okay.
When we say nothing major, it means it's mostly wines.
Yeah, basically. There's one beer and it's not that great a name, but you know, we'll let you know when these things stand out. And definitely you're going to be checking this all out your own. And hopefully you're going to let us know what you like so we can share. Okay, so we're moving on to Earth Eats, hosted by Impossible Foods. I should know what Impossible Foods are, but I don't. Oh, I think I knew. Isn't it the fake meat guys? Impossible? Like the Burger King was supposed to get new burgers? We'll have to find out more about that. But they keep using trademark in the title, so here we go. The Impossible Burger Slider with wasabi cream and a spicy Asian slaw on a sesame bun, seed bun. And they do list it as vegan, so yeah, I'm pretty sure this is the fake burger guys. Also, they have the Impossible Cottage Pie. This actually sounds good. Impossible ground meat with carrots, mushrooms, and peas, topped with mashed cauliflower, white beans, and mozzarella. That's basically possible for both of those for me. As far as the beverage goes, I don't know what this is. They're both trademark Suja, and then it's organic kombucha, green apple, or pineapple, or mixed berry. So yeah, so I guess they're kind of healthy drinks is what they're going to be. And I like the flavors.
So you're ready for the definition? Is it the
Burger King guys?
I don't know if it's the Burger King guys, but it's basically they make burgers. And it says to replicate the fat in hamburgers made from cows, Impossible Foods use flecks of coconut fat, which were mixed with ground textured wheat and potato protein.
Interesting.
I think I'll just skip to the...
Oh, you're going to... You know what? Someone's going to have to get one of those just to try it.
I'm going to hop over to Australia and get some pro meat.
Get an extra lamb chop.
Yes.
Okay, so moving on. Now, this one is an odd one, and I don't remember it from last year, but I could be wrong. It's Emile's Fromage Montage. So we're joining Remy's brother Emile on a stroll around Epcot. Oh, this is the game. No?
No, it's not. Yeah, do.
Enjoy a variety of delicious cheeses served in inventive ways. Purchase 5 fabulous fromages and reward yourself with a corresponding stamp in your festival passport. Then bring your festival passport to a Shimmering Sips for a complimentary specialty cheesecake unique to the Epcot International Food and Wine Festival.
So one of the things you have to eat is that stupid Impossible meat.
Oh, we don't have to eat it. You just have to buy it.
Just have to buy it.
Feel free to try 5 different items or return to the same location to revisit a favorite. So you get the same 5. Yeah.
So you don't have to try all 5. You can do two at the cheese studio.
Sure. Complete Emile's Fromage Montage at your own pace in one day or over several days during this year's Epcot International Food and Wine. So they have them located at Earth Eats, the Cheese Studio, the Alps, Germany, Brazil, and Shimmering Sips. Ooh, that name seems interesting.
That's the one. That's Shimmering Sips was in the Festival Center last time, and they did a bunch of different types of champagnes, I guess you would call it, or just bubbly drinks.
Okay, sounds cool. Now, one of the things they say down here, it's not, what is it? Oh, while supplies last. So be careful about that. We planned last year all around going to the food and wine so we can go to the, what was that one center called? The experimental place with all the really cool drinks that were bubbly and tasted different.
Like neon green. That's the place that had like the black lights in it.
Right, right. And the whole deal was you bought this one specific drink. You got it in a beaker that you could take home with you. They were out of those in the first 2 weeks. So you got to take some of these items with a grain of salt if they're going to be there once you get there. Okay, so moving on. Flavors from Fire, hosted by ESPN's College Game Day. Now, Flavors from Fire, I think, was, again, another one of those kiosk food stands up by Club Cool.
Was.
And this one looks good. Steakhouse Blended Burger. Blended beef and mushroom slider with brie cheese fondue, arugula, and a truffle, and blue cheese potato chip and on a brioche bun. That's a lot to put on a little bun.
I'm skipping Impossible Burger for that right there.
Yeah, right. You can also get yourself some smoked corned beef with crispy potatoes, cheese curds, pickled onions, and beer cheese fondue. Again, it sounds like a lot of different things on one little taste.
Sounds so good, though. Oh, this is the next one. Sounds good, too.
And that's what I think that picture is. Charred chimichurri skirt steak on a smoked corn cake with pickled vegetable slaw and cilantro.
Aioli.
Aioli. Now, you know, I'm not a big cornbread fan, believe it or not, but everything else looks good on that one.
Oh, they have something similar to that at Skipper Canteen. They're called cachapas, and they're little corn cakes, and they have, like, this beef on pork on top of them, and they're delicious. Oh, okay. God.
Oh, yeah, and you know what they don't have? They don't have another one of our favorites. They don't have the pig wings, piggy wiggies, pig wing, what were those things? Because they do offer a beverage, the swine brine, featuring Jim Beam's bourbon. But the whole idea was you had one of those piggy wings, like, kind of leaning on the edge of that thing for it.
Yep, sure did.
So they don't have them at all, at least at this food place?
Doesn't look like it.
That's going to be interesting to see if they have them at all. That was a big favorite. Okay, moving on to France. And wouldn't you know it, they have French food there. How about that?
I will give you a pro tip on France.
Okay.
When you're walking over the bridge, like from the UK into France, a lot of times at that booth right there, there's a long line. But if you pass up the booth and go to the other side, there's usually another line on the other side that's much shorter. Just people don't take the time to walk around the back side of the booth that faces the pavilion.
Right, right. Oh, yeah, very cool. Always look for that second line.
Yep.
Okay, so now they've got a bunch of stuff that I'm not going to be able to pronounce, but I'll try. Do you want to try it? You're down there. You should know this a little bit more than me, French.
I don't know that.
Well, you got a fondue.
Fondue Savoyard.
Right, which is basically a bunch of imported cheeses and Chardonnay.
With croutons.
Ooh.
Croissant au escargot. So it's an escargot croissant with garlic and parsley,
which they have every year. And if you've never had one of those, it's basically like a little roll with a snail right in the side of it, like a prize. So it's like you're biting through it. Sometimes you get it, sometimes you don't. Not a big fan. Anyway,
next one is bœuf braisé à la bordelaise, pomme dauphine.
Yeah, we should just go right to the description.
And it's beef braised in a Cabernet Sauvignon with red onions and puffed potatoes.
Now, I'm pretty sure they had both of those items, the escargot and that, both last couple years.
You got this last one nailed. Creme brulee.
Right.
With smeade chocolate hazelnut cream.
Awesome. Very good.
And
the drinks are probably a bunch of champagne, right?
No, actually, one of the really good drinks here is the La Passion Martini Slushy. Basically, it's like the normal one. They normally do like the...
They add the passion fruit to it. Right, the Grey Goose...
they do the Grey Goose Citron, and then right. The citrus one, and then they do the orange one. Grand Marnier Orange Slush.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a passion fruit one.
Awesome. Yeah, I always kind of hit that French place for those things. The slushies are really good.
Yep.
Okay, moving on to Germany. Now, this is one of the questions I always have, is that they have the Epcot Food and Wine. Why do they have kiosks with the countries they have at Epcot?
Well, because I think you still, they still have stuff that's a tasting menu that you can't get at the quick service. You know what I mean? Like, this one has the roast bratwurst and a pretzel roll. Well, you can't get that in a tasting menu at the quick service. You got to get a whole thing.
Right. Well, I always found it difficult because it's such a great thing, and then they don't have it year-round. When they have the restaurant right there, I should get my brat and a pretzel every day of the year.
Good point. I like it. It's delicious, too. I've had it.
Oh, no doubt. They have the Schinken Noodlin.
I was leaving that one up to you. You're German, aren't you?
That was horrible. Pasta gratin with ham, onions, and cheese. The roast bratwurst in the prop impeller. You know, they have a name for the pretzel roll now. That's incredible. A prop impeller pretzel roll. Yeah.
So I guess it's just the brand.
Yes. But. Yeah, exactly what it is, which is so crazy. I wonder how much you pay to get your brand name on this list. And then they have the apple strudel with vanilla sauce for dessert. Such great beers. Now, one of the tips, and I forget if it was you or Sam that keeps coming up with this one, but it's a great one. Don't forget, guys, as you're walking around Epcot, you can get yourself a beer at the normal Epcot restaurants or, like, you know, fast service places that are full beers. And if you finally get tired of those 4-ounce samplers, yeah. And Germany's one of the prime places. And sometimes you're getting special beers for the Food and Wine Festival at the normal, like, just locations in Germany.
Yep.
Okay, moving on to another big, big favorite, Hawaii. This has been a big one for the last 5 years, maybe. And the pork slider has been a staple for me. If I've had something bad or if I'm having like an off day because of the heat, no matter what, the pork slider, it's always great.
I really want to try the next one, which is the grilled tuna tataki with seaweed salad, pickled cucumbers, and wasabi cream. Inspired by Aulani, Disney Vacation Club Villas, and Ko'alini, Hawaii.
So it's like you're there, right? When you close your
That's
eyes and
awesome
take a bite.
That they found a way to market Aulani in the DVC and the menu.
Sure.
Which is smart.
A quick note, going back to the candy sushi we mentioned for the kids over at the land, that was sponsored by Disney Adventures. So as you're talking about cross-advertising, well, there you go. Disney Adventures is bringing an activity into the parks, and then somebody gets to ask, what's Disney Adventures? Well, they'll tell you all about it.
That's awesome.
Yep. So they also have, and again, this is another one of those odd ones where you hear the name and you kind of like wrinkle your like lip at it, but then it's like such a great thing that you got to try it. The teriyaki glazed spam hash with potatoes, peppers, onions, and spicy mayo.
I bet it's delicious.
It is really good. And I'm actually a spam. I don't mind spam at all. I think it's not that bad.
Hash like that with potatoes is I like spam too.
And then when they dress it up like this, yeah, you're right. It can't be beat. And then for dessert, they have a passion fruit cheesecake with macadamias. Oh, excuse me.
Sounds very Hawaiian.
It does. Now, I tell you what, the offerings they have for beverages, not too out of control. However, we're talking about Hawaii, yet they have the Florida Orange Grove sparkling pineapple wine here. I do not get that choice.
I guess because it's pineapple and it's and you know, it's the Kahlua pork slider is sponsored by, you know, Dole, and it's pineapple chutney.
Fair enough. I'll give it to them there. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
I was going to say the last one on there, the Aulani Sunrise, which is themed to Aulani. Again, it's vodka, Dole pineapple juice, and grenadine, which is. It's pineapple juice and vodka.
But isn't that a. Oh, okay. No, that's like a tequila sunrise with vodka. Is what that
tequila
is.
Tequila sunrise with vodka.
That's what I was looking
for. It's
an
Aulani. It's an Aulani sunrise.
You know, that could be my next favorite drink. That actually looks a really, really good one too.
It's probably delicious.
Yeah. Okay. Well, definitely something to look for.
And I will tell you, you know, another thing is that you don't see that many cocktails. You see more wine and beer and ciders.
Right. Now, I tell you what, the cocktails actually are more expensive. But they also reflect that they're coming in a real cup more times than not. So it's a real kind of normal, like, solo-type cup situation. Okay, so we're moving on to hops and barley, which is another one that you're going to automatically think it's all about the beer, but it's not. This is another one of those favorites and mainstays that they have a couple of, and it's actually everything's back again this year, where we're starting out with the New England lobster roll. Now, this is the other $9 item on the menu, other than the filet mignon that you get at Epcot, and this is a really good one.
I was going to say, you know, these are like, if you're there and you're in Disney, they're in Food and Wine, and you're in the dining plan, this is like one of the best freaking things you can use your snack credit for.
Right, which again, and if you don't know and you don't realize this, your snack credits can be used for the majority of the items at Food and Wine. You go around, you look at the menus, they have the snack icon next to all the items that you can get, and there's very, very rare that you don't have one next to an item.
So think about it. I mean, you could get three waters. Use three snack credits to get water for the same dollar amount that you could use one to get the. You know what I'm saying? Like a water's $3.
So and I gotta wonder if you can use the snack credit for the lobster roll or not. But yeah, if you
can. Has been in the past.
Yeah, and it probably is. I mean, that's a great deal. Now, the other one they have there, the other meal, is the New Brunswick Slider, slow-braised beef brisket, pot roast style, with horseradish cream, crispy fried onions, potato roll, pickled vegetables on the side. Very good. Another good one.
Sounds really good.
And they got carrot cake for dessert. And as far as the beers go, again, kind of standard beers and wines, things like that, some cool names.
They used to do better with these.
Well, I would have thought hops and barley, they would have had definitely a lot more beers. I'm sure they had in the past.
They used to always have been, my home brewery is Abita, so they used to always have like a Purple Haze or one of the Abita beers. I hadn't seen that in years.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Cool. Now we're moving on to India. And for some reason, I don't remember hearing India before. Is that new, or am I just going a little crazy here?
I'm not 100% sure, but it looks like some good stuff here.
So we're starting out with warm Indian bread with pickled garlic, mango salsa, and a coriander pesto dip. So definitely sounds very light. Moving on to a Madras red curry with roasted cauliflower, baby carrots, chickpea, and Uncle Ben's
basmati
rice. And then, both are vegetarian meals. And then finally some meat. Korma chicken with cucumber tomato salad, almonds, cashews, and warm naan bread. Nothing's really jumping out at me, but maybe once we start seeing some of the samples going around, maybe something might get to there. One of the beverages, which really doesn't match India in my eyes, is called Godfather Lager.
Hmm.
Yeah, I mean, the other ones are kind of Sula Chenin Blanc or Sula Shiraz or Mango Lassi. I mean, things that could be Indian.
Yeah.
Godfather Lager. I wonder if that goes the whole, like, the mafia route, or is it just like, dad? Now we'll have to find out. Okay, moving a little closer to home, we're going to Ireland next. So now Ireland's been a little bit different each year. So let's see which way they're going. Starting out with roasted Irish sausage with cold cannon potatoes and onion gravy. And now this is an odd one because Ireland tends to be close to Canada as far as the kiosk location the last couple of years. And yeah. They also offer an Irish cheddar cheese and stout dip with Irish brown bread, which is real, real similar to the cheddar cheese soup over in Canada. They call it a dip, but it's, the cheese over in Canada is pretty thick to begin with, too.
It's interesting. This is not what they've had before. There was a seafood pie, like a...
Oh, right. Yep, that's correct. Which I kind of never gotten the hang for that. So I don't miss it. But that's it. Just those two offerings plus a dessert, a warm chocolate pudding with Irish cream liqueur custard. As far as the beverage offerings, I did get the mead, the honey wine last year, which was really, really good. I see a Guinness Bailey's shake. I'm not a fan, but if you do like Bailey's a lot, I'm sure that's going to be good for you too.
Brahan Brewhouse Killiney Red Ale. I mean, that's all Irish right there.
Yeah, big time. Okay, moving on to the islands of the Caribbean. And this basically took the place of, didn't we have an island at one point somewhere down in the Caribbean? Did we have Jamaica at one point? Or I'm not sure.
Maybe, yeah.
But anyway, so we got the Ropa Villa Empanada with tomato aioli. Jerk spiced chicken with roasted sweet plantain salad and mango chutney. The jerk chicken is always good. And the quesito puff pastry with sweetened cream cheese and guava sauce.
Oh, God, that sounds good.
It does. The sweetened cream cheese and guava sauce can't be beat, I'm sure.
I think we did have Jamaica at one time, and the fact that they have Red Stripe Lager makes me think this is taking the place of that.
Maybe, but then again, Red Stripe is kind of like the stereotypical Caribbean beer regardless. I know it's Jamaican and all that, but yeah. But yeah, I definitely remember it because I remember when they brought it together to the island, so it had to be something else. And this is the place to get your frozen mojitos.
Which is probably really good.
Anything like that frozen is awesome. Okay, so we're moving on to Italy. Now, again, Italy, and you know what? To be honest with you, I was asking that question before when we talked Germany. And Italy, I kind of get it because you can't get small samples like this at Italy. You have to, sit down, you have to order it, and you have to actually pay for a meal. So...
Well, because there's no quick service at all in Italy, right?
Right. So, at least, there's the pizza place, but that's not really, I guess, quick service. But, right, you can't get a small little taste of a meal. So, yeah. Ravioli carbonara is the first offering. Parmesan Pecorino ravioli, egg yolk, cream, and bacon.
I was just about to make a joke about how you could pronounce all the stuff on this menu, and you completely ruined my joke.
Well, you know what? It's kind of like I don't ever read the names. I know the names. I just don't ever kind of have to read them. Constantine D. Mahale, balsamic glazed and oven roasted pork ribs. That's definitely different. That's new. For chicken, they've got crispy chicken with marinara sauce. Sounds pretty plain. Hopefully they kind of dress that up a little bit. They have for dessert cannolis, which are, actually doctored up with chocolate or candied orange. And then chocolate hazelnut cake, which sounds pretty good too.
It all sounds good to me. I love Italian food.
Yep. The standard looks like the margarita. Look at the flavor for the margarita.
Oh, Sam talked about that before. That's his wife's favorite is the Italian margarita because they make it with limoncello.
And tequila.
Yep. Both.
So awesome. As we're moving along, almost done as we're hitting Japan next. So now Japan's always been hit and miss, and they've changed a bunch of different things up over the last couple of years. They're going to start out with a teriyaki chicken bun. Steam bun filled with chicken, vegetables, and sweet teriyaki. Well, there's your duck right there, kind of. And that steamed bun is kind of like that China bun. They were kind of similar. Frothy ramen, chilled noodles, and dashi broth with light foam topping. That sounds odd. First of all, it's chilled. And everybody knows what the ramen noodles are. Dashi. Yeah, I'm going to have to look up dashi to find out what that is.
Ramen noodles are not the dry pack of ramen noodles that most people are used to. You go up to the quick service in Japan and get the ramen noodles, they are really good. Completely different than what you would expect.
Right. Okay. Well, definitely maybe something to try. That light foam topping has me worried, though, too. If it's fish related, that's what I have to make sure, because you never know Japan what they're going to kind of put in there fish-wise. And then they also have the spicy roll, tuna, and salmon sushi topped with volcano sauce. They have that every year. Kirin draft beer. I like Kirin beer. It's very good.
I do too.
And I do like sake. So they do have a cocktail, a Nami sake cocktail. It's sake, gin, and blue curacao. Well, that could be interesting. That sounds actually kind of like a martini-ish to drink called a Windex.
It's curacao.
Oh, sorry. Mexico. So now Mexico's kind of changed up a little bit, but it's always been good.
Yeah.
Taco de puerco. Shredded pork belly on a corn tortilla with salsa verde. Well, there you go. Second pork belly
on the loop. That's gotta be delicious.
Tostada de carne. Braised beef on a corn tostada with mole. I can't pronounce that next word. And chicharrón dust.
That's the pork belly. I mean, like the fried pork skins.
Oh, okay. Okay. And then capriotada de chocolate, chocolate bread pudding served with chocolate abuelita cream and glaze. Don't know what that is, but it sounds really good.
First two sound really, really good.
Yeah. And the drink's pretty standard. A lot of tequila, a lot of good stuff in there. A smoky margarita. Classic margarita and some wines and stuff. Okay, moving on. Morocco. So now, again, Morocco is not another country that's standing out to me as far as having visited. They had, the hummus fries were big for the last couple of years. Other than that, I haven't. But they are going to maybe change my mind. They're starting out with the New York strip steak, green shemola flatbread with fresh radish and tomato salsa.
Sounds good.
It does. They do have the spicy hummus fries with cucumber, tomatoes, onions, tzatziki sauce, and chipotle sauce. And chocolate baklava for dessert. That looks good. Drinks, standard stuff. Although, Mimosa Royale, sparkling wine and orange juice topped with orange liqueur. So, I'm sure there's somebody out there that wants that. Here's a place that looks new. Shimmering Sips Mimosa Bar. What do you think? Ever heard that one before?
Yeah, that was there last year. We tried a couple different mimosas there.
Gotcha. Banana almond soft serve sundae, cheesecake trio, Shimmering Strawberry Soft Serve. So basically a dessert place all the way around. And then...
We tried all... They had like three different mimosas last year.
They got a bunch. They got a tropical, a key lime, a blood orange, a frozen with White Claw natural lime hard seltzer. Okay. And a bunch of champagne after that. Straight champagne without the...
Inside the festival center, if you went to the right, that was that bar right there.
Okay.
Last year. Now, the years before, it was always beer and stuff, but the last year they changed it to... We went there with Kathy and Adi last year.
I don't know if I...
We went there twice.
I don't even know if I went into the center last year, come to think of it. Ooh, I'm looking forward to this year. Got a little extra time to get around. Okay, so we're moving on to Spain. Charcuterie in a cone with imported Spanish meats, cheeses, and olives with an herb vinaigrette. Had that last year. We'll have it again this year. That was pretty good.
I love the charcuterie stuff. I love the cheeses and the meats and the olives. I mean, it's good stuff.
Mm-hmm. Spanish style paella with batafara. Don't know what that is. And roasted chicken. And a seafood salad with shrimp, bay scallops, mussels, extra virgin olive oil, vinegar, and paprika. Definitely sounds really good. Drinks wise, standard wines. And again, Spain, that'll be one that if I'm passing by, something looks good, I'll probably stop. I'm not sure if that's going to be one I'm going to beelining to.
That's pretty rare cone, though. I mean, that's...
Yeah, that is true. That is a good one, like I said.
And
it's
in the cone, so you can kind of grab it and walk around with it. You know what I mean?
Made for walking.
Yeah. Got its own vessel.
So we're moving on to Thailand. Marinated chicken with peanut sauce and stirred fried vegetables.
Love peanut sauce.
And again, that's a bold thing to do with all the peanut allergies out there. But yeah, you're right. It's awesome. Shrimp and cold noodle salad or a red hot spicy Thai curry beef with steamed rice.
That's right up my alley.
Yeah, all three of those things actually probably could be pretty good. Yep. And beverages, very limited. Not that much there. A lager and I think, wine.
With that being said, the wine is a good version of Wiener. But the lager definitely looks like it could be Thai. It's Singha.
Yeah, yeah. Which so is looks, great. I mean,
looks,
that's,
it looks like it fits that booth because some of them haven't.
And I tell you what, I'd love to kind of try beers out from around the world. You never know when you're going to get something that's very good.
Yep.
For the good or the bad, you find something you're really going to like, unfortunately, you might get home and not be able to get it. Yep. Okay, so moving on, we're almost done. We're at the Wine and Dine Studio. Now, this is basically, I guess, meals and things like that from California. What's the Golden State?
California, yeah. From the Golden State Trinidad Vineyard. So it's California wine, basically.
Nice. Starting out with a little seafood, some seared scallops, truffled celery root, puree, Brussels sprouts, and wild mushrooms. Moving on to the butternut squash ravioli with brown butter vinaigrette. Brown butter vinaigrette. Okay, Parmesan cheese and pumpkin seeds. Trio of artisan cheeses or the artist palette of wine and cheese. So definitely more of a kind of like hang out, drink your wine, and enjoy your food place.
Seared scallops. I love seared scallops.
Yeah, now I kind of thought they were at a different place last year. One of those places by Club Cool. I wonder if it's kind of just a different location or if it's this is the place I'm thinking.
I think the Wine and Dine Studio was on that pathway, like if behind Club Cool, but if you took that other pathway kind of by Imagination toward World Showcase, it was down there on the right.
Okay, very cool. So, guys, that's basically the marketplaces that we have for the food and wine this year. Of course, a lot of the places that are at Epcot all the time have their specials, and we're going to be going over those as we kind of get closer to food and wine and we get into it, because there are some really, really good things that only come around once a year. So I'm getting my list ready, Jimmy. I can't wait to get out there.
We were talking about this earlier, but you're going to be on a little bit longer of a trip than you used to. So we'll have some days to, you'll have a little more time, than you normally do to try some of these things.
Mm-hmm. Definitely looking forward to it. Okay, guys. So tell me what you're looking for. Let us know, And actually, once you guys get closer and you start attending Food and Wine, we want to hear all about your reviews. Jimmy, tell everybody how to get in touch with the show.
You can email us at questions@thedisneynerdspodcast.com and email us individually at ed@thedisneynerdspodcast.com, jimmy@thedisneynerdspodcast.com, etc. You can send us a message on Facebook to the page, The Disney Nerds Podcast. Join our group, Disney Nerds. Instagram @TheDisneyNerdsPodcast and Twitter @TheDisneyNerds. Make sure to check out the website, www.TheDisneyNerdsPodcast.com, and watch the live stream every Tuesday night at 9 o'clock Walt Disney World time.
Okay, guys, so that's it for show number 298, the Food and Wine Experience. We are so set for it. I hope you guys are too. So for Jimmy, this is Ed, and we're the Disney Nerds. We'll talk to you next week. Bye-bye.
Quaharini.
There's a simple rule that's compulsory.